Let's give another Youth Day welcome to Father Greg Boyle.
Thank you very much. It's a privilege to be with all of you on the Jumbotron. I didn't know I was bald. Thank you very much. Thank you to the organizers for pointing that out. I worked with gangs for 30 years, and so they wanted me to talk to you. For 30 years, the homies have taught me everything of value, and I'm so grateful to them. There's a homie who's running the place right now named Lewis, heroin addict, a gang member, been to prison, felon, shot caller. Now he runs Homeboy Industries for me. He's become something of a public speaker himself. He's pretty good at it. The other night at dinner, he was giving me tips on how to speak to a crowd. He says, you have to pepper your talk with self-defecating humor. I said, yeah, no shit. So brace yourselves. What Martin Luther King says about church could well be said of your day here at Youth Day. It's not the place you've come to, it's always going to be the place you go from. And you go from here and you have a vision. It's not just about talking Jesus, it's about living as though the truth were true. It's about putting first things recognizably first. It's about living the gospel. That's the only thing that matters to Jesus. He wants you to live the gospel. So there's a vision. The prophet Habakkuk writes, the vision still has its time, presses on to fulfillment, and it will not disappoint. And if it delays, wait for it. But none of us want to wait, you know, con los brazos cruzados, you know, tapping our feet, staring at our watches, waiting for something to happen. You want to make it happen. And what Jesus wants you to make happen is to create a community of kinship such that God, in fact, might recognize it. Mother Teresa diagnosed the world's ills correctly when she suggested that the problem in the world is that we've just forgotten that we belong to each other. So how do we stand against forgetting that? How do we imagine a circle of compassion and then imagine nobody standing outside that circle? How do we dismantle the barriers that exclude? How do we find ourselves at the margins, which is where Pope Francis would like the church to stand, at the margins? And if you look under your feet, the margins are getting erased because you chose to stand there. And you stand with particular people, with the poor and the powerless and the voiceless. You stand with those whose dignity has been denied. You stand with those whose burdens are more than they can bear. Every once in a while, all of you in this room, you've had this particular privilege to be able to stand with the easily despised and the readily left out, with the demonized so that the demonizing will stop, and with the disposable so that the day will come when we stop throwing people away. I suspect that if kinship was our goal, we would no longer be promoting justice, we'd be celebrating it. Because no kinship, no justice. No kinship, no peace. So for 30 years, the gang members have rescued me, saved me, liberated me, and taught me everything of value. But in the last couple of years, they've taught me how to text, and I'm so grateful to them because I find it sure beats the heck out of actually talking to people. And I'm pretty good at it, LOL and OMG and BTW, and the homies have taught me a new one, OHN, which apparently stands for, oh, hell no. And I've been using that one quite a bit lately. So there I am with two older vatos, Manuel and Poncho. Apparently they're here today. And so we're in the car, and they're older guys, tattooed, been to prison. They're going to help me give a talk. And so we're driving. And Manuel's in the front seat, and 15 minutes in, he gets an incoming text, and he reads it to himself, and he chuckles. And I said, well, you know, who is it? He goes, well, it's dumb. It's from Snoopy back at the office. Well, I'd just seen Snoopy. Snoopy gave me a big old abrazo. Snoopy and Manuel work together in the clock-in room where they clock in hundreds and hundreds of our workers, all gang members. It's a hard job because gang members can occasionally be attitudinal. I say, well, what's he saying? And he goes, oh, it's dumb. Hang on a second. Hey, dog, it's me, Snoops. Yeah, they got my ass locked up at county jail. They're charging me with being the ugliest vato in America. You have to come down right now, show them they got the wrong guy. Well, we died laughing, the three of us, and nearly drove into oncoming traffic. And then I realized that Manuel and Snoopy are enemies. They're from rival gangs. They used to shoot bullets at each other. Now they shoot text messages. And there's a word for that, and the word is kinship. How do we obliterate once and for all the illusion that we're separate, that there is an us and a them? All of you in this room engage in some kind of service, which is good. That's where you begin. But service is the hallway that gets you to the arena. You want to get to the arena, which is the place of kinship and exquisite mutuality, because there's a difference and a distance sometimes in service. I'm the service provider, you're the service recipient. You want to bridge even that distance. One of the great privileges of my life was knowing Cesar Chavez as a friend. And he was a great man in all the ways we've come to think of his greatness. He was the best listener I ever met in my life. If you were talking to Cesar Chavez, you were the only person who existed in the world. He wasn't looking over your shoulder to see if somebody more important was on the approach. Well, once famously, a reporter had commented to him and said, wow, these farm workers, they sure love you. And Cesar just shrugged and smiled and said, the feeling's mutual, which of course is the goal. How do we get to this place of mutual transformation where there is no daylight that separates us? There was a homie I knew, a name, everybody called him Dreamer, and nobody found more job opportunities through Homeboy Industries than this guy. I knew him since he was a mocosito growing up in the housing projects. And a very funny kid, very super smart, never went to school too much, but he had a dangerous sense of humor that I always liked. But he got into trouble, got into a gang, would get locked up. But in his early 20s, this guy was a yo-yo. He was always in and out of being locked up. But he'd come back to me all the time, and I'd find him another job opportunity. But he'd sometimes, would in those days, gravitate back to vague criminality, usually something involving drugs, the sale of or the use of, and then he'd wander back to Homeboy. And this one time, he had finished a four-month stretch probation violation at county jail, and there he is sitting in front of me, and he says what gang members often say, this time it'll be different. I go, all right. So with him sitting there, I call a friend of mine who runs a vending machine company in Alhambra, California. And he had hired homies in the past. Maybe he'll do it again. Sure enough, he says, tell this guy he starts tomorrow. That's a holy man right there. So Dreamer began work at the vending machine company. Well, 2 weeks later, there he is sitting in front of my desk again. I go, Híjole, Madre Santa, here we go again. But this time, he pulls out of his pocket his very first paycheck, and he says, Damn, G, this paycheck makes me feel proper. I mean, my jefita, she's proud of me, and my moritos, they're not ashamed of me. And you know who I have to thank for this job. And I said, well, gosh, who? And he looked at me strangely and he said, well, God, of course. Oh, yeah, no. No, that's right. That would be God right there, yeah. You thought I was going to say you. I said, no, gosh, God's number one, yeah. He said, you are so lucky we're not living in them Genesis days. I'm sorry, them Genesis days? He goes, yeah, because God would have been had struck down your ass already by now. Well, I guess he told me, but all I remember was we dissolved in laughter. We fell out of our chairs, and I defy you to identify exactly who's the service provider, who's the service recipient. It's mutual. That's God's dream come true. This Youth Day is not the place you've come to, it's the place you go from, so that we might be one and in kinship with each other. So Homeboy Industries was born a long time ago, 1988, when I was pastor of the poorest parish in the city of Los Angeles, Dolores Mission Church. Oh my God, they let you in. Just kidding. And so nestled in the middle of two public housing projects at that time, and had eight gangs at war with each other, and the police called it the place of the highest concentration of gang activity in the world, was my parish. I buried my first young person killed because of this sadness in 1988. And I buried my 198th last week. So we did a lot of things. We started a school because there were so many middle school, junior high age gang members who had been given the boot from their home school. Nobody wanted them. And they were violent and wreaking havoc and writing on the walls. So I went to them and I said, if I found a school that would take you, would you go? And to my surprise, they all said, yes. And then I couldn't find a school that would take them, you know, So our elementary school, parochial school, is right across the street from the church, and so the first two floors are the school. The whole third floor was the convent. So I gathered all the nuns together in the living room, and I said, hey, would you guys mind, you know, moving out, and and we could turn the convent into a school for gang members? And they said, sure. Where would we be without nuns? So this brought gang members to the church, and this upset the apple cart, because our church is supposed to be hermetically sealed, good people in, bad people out, and that was a good gospel challenge. And then they said, if only we had jobs. And then myself and the women in the parish, we marched around the projects to all the factories trying to find felony-friendly employers, and that wasn't so forthcoming. So we invented crews, graffiti removal, maintenance, landscaping, and it wasn't enough. So I went to a movie producer who happened to have $500 million. I said, hey, break bread, kick us down with something. And so he ended up buying this old abandoned bakery across the street from the church. We put hair nets on gang members, rivals, enemies. They baked bread, and we called it Homeboy Bakery. A month later, we started Homeboy Tortillas in the Grand Central Market. Once we had plural, we came up with the highfalutin Homeboy Industries, as if there was any industry involved. Not everything worked. Some things didn't work very well, like Homeboy Plumbing was not a huge success. Who knew? People didn't want gang members in their homes. I did not see that coming. And now nobody intends to ever do something like this, but we backed our way into becoming the largest gang intervention rehab and reentry program in the United States of America. So 15,000 folks a year walk through our doors. There are 100,000 gang members in LA County, 1,100 gangs, and we offer everything. Our centerpiece is our 18-month training program. It's a place of healing and hope, a chance to redirect your lives. We have all sorts of curricular things, from anger management to grief and loss to GED, and we still have a school. We have free tattoo removal. No place on the planet Earth removes more, at least gang-related tattoos, than we do. We have a designated clinic with three laser machines, one paid physician assistant, but 47 volunteer doctors, 50,000 laser treatments a year. It was all started because of a guy named Frank who wandered into my office. I'd never met him before. 2 days out of Corcoran State Prison. And we have some prisoners here. Glad they gave you that day pass. And I'd never met him before, and right out of prison, and he's sitting there in front of my desk, and pardon my French here, but tattooed on his forehead, it said, "Fuck the world." Yeah. And he looked at me and he said, "You know, I am having a hard time finding a job." I said, "Well, Frank, maybe we could put our heads together on this one, you know." So I found a doctor who at a hospital had a laser machine. He gave me 1 hour a month to chip away at Frank's forehead and a few others. Pretty soon I had a waiting list of 3,000 gang members who wanted this service. So we couldn't stay with that arrangement. Parentheses, Frank is now a security guard at a movie studio, and there is no trace of the dumbest, angriest thing he had ever decided to do in his life. Proving once and for all, as Sister Helen Prejean says, all of us are a whole lot more than the worst things we've ever done. Truth be told, there isn't a person on the planet who doesn't believe in a God of second chances. And so we have all our businesses, the Homeboy Solar Panel training program. We have Homeboy Diner, the only place you can get food at City Hall. We have a restaurant at American Airlines Terminal 4. We have farmers markets, about 40 of those. We have Homeboy Grocery, where we sell chips and salsas and other food items at all the Ralphs in California. What else do we have? Homeboy Silkscreen is thriving. Homeboy Bakery. Homeboy Homegrown Merchandise. And you can buy that stuff out at the table. And Homegirl Cafe, where women with records, young ladies from rival gangs, waitresses with attitude, will gladly take your order. A lot of famous people show up there, a lot of elected officials. Jim Carrey, the movie star, was there not long ago. A couple weeks ago, actually, I was on retreat, so I wasn't there. And we got 2 hour notice, a phone call from the Secret Service to tell us that Joe Biden, the Vice President of the United States, was gonna have lunch there. And so his motorcade came, and a homie afterwards, he said, "Hey, gee, while you were gone on retreat, we had a visit from an MVP. I said, "Do you mean a VIP?" He goes, "That one, yeah. Damn, gee, imagine here at Homeboy Industries, we were visited by the Vice President of the United States, Mitt Romney." So, yeah, current affairs was not he needs to go to that class, I think. Anyway, one day we had Diane Keaton show up for lunch, a movie star, Oscar winner, Godfather movies, big movie star. She's having lunch with a regular. Her waitress is Glenda. She's a big girl, been to prison, tattooed, felon. gang member. She has no clue who Diane Keaton is, so she's taking her order. And Diane Keaton says, "What do you recommend?" And Glinda rattles off the three platillos that she particularly likes. And Diane Keaton says, "Oh, I'll have that second one. That one sounds good." And it's at that moment, for some reason, something dawns on Glinda, and she looks at Diane Keaton. She says, "Wait a minute. I feel like I know you. You know, like maybe we've met." And Diane Keaton decides to deflect it humbly. "Oh, gosh, I don't know. I suppose I have one of those faces that people think they've seen before." And Glinda goes, "No, now I know. We were locked up together." Yeah, that just took my breath away when I heard it. And I don't believe we've had any further Diane Keaton sightings now that I think of it. But suddenly, kinship so quickly, Oscar-winning actress, attitudinal waitress, exactly what God had in mind. And we need go no further than to hear Jesus speaking to the gathered, that you may be one. He'd actually like us to talk less about him and be about kinship more. That's his dream come true, that we be one. He could have said, I suppose, more things about himself, but he wants it to be about us. All of us are called to be what Alice Miller, the late great child psychologist, called enlightened witnesses, people who through your kindness and tenderness and focused, attentive love return people to themselves. You don't hold the bar up and ask anybody to measure up. You just show up and hold the mirror up and tell people the truth, knowing that your truth is my truth and my truth is a gang member's truth, and it all happens to be the same truth, and here's the truth. You are exactly what God had in mind when God made you. And then you watch folks, particularly on the margins, as they become that truth, as they inhabit that truth, and no bullet can pierce it, no four prison walls can keep it out, and death can't touch it because it's huge. But you always have to reach in and dismantle the messages of shame and disgrace that get in the way, that keep people from seeing their truth. Marcus Borg says that the principal suffering of the poor throughout history is shame and disgrace, and I think that's quite right. Take a leisurely stroll through the Acts of the Apostles, and you can read it as a quaint snapshot of life in the earliest Christian community, or you can read it as the measure of health in any community at all. Things will leap off the page. Things like, see how they love one another. It's not about talking, it's about loving. There's nobody needy in this community. My favorite one, though, is an odd one, and it goes like this: and awe came upon everyone. It would seem that the measure of our health as a community, as a church, may well reside in our ability to stand in awe at what the poor have to carry, rather than stand in judgment at how they carry it. So some years ago, I was invited to speak at a conference of social workers, 600 social workers in Richmond, Virginia. I didn't read the stuff very well. I thought I would be giving a keynote speech. Finally, I looked at it and it said, it's a gang in service, 9 to 5. I was to be the only speaker. So I invited two homies into my office, Jose and Andre, and I said, look, you're flying with me to Richmond, Virginia. I want you to get up and tell your stories. Take your time, because we got a long-ass day to fill. So I had never heard their stories, and Jose got up, 25 years old, gang member, been to prison, entered our program in the janitorial phase, but worked his way up to be a valued member of our substance abuse department, a man solidly in his recovery himself. Also a man who had spent a time, a stretch as a homeless man, but also a longer stretch as a heroin addict. And he gets up to tell his stories, and he says, in an offhanded kind of way, he says, I guess you could say my mom and me, we didn't get along so good. I think I was 6 when she looked at me and she said, why don't you just kill yourself? You're such a burden to me. Well, 600 social workers gasped. And then he said, it sounds way worse in Spanish. And people did what you did. I think I was 9 when my mom drove me down to the deepest part of Baja California. And she walks up to an orphanage. And she knocks on the door. And the man comes to the door and she says, I found this kid. And she left me there for 90 days until my grandmother could get out of her where she had dumped me. And my grandmother came and rescued me. My mom beat me every single day of my elementary school years with things you could imagine and a lot of things you couldn't. Every day my back was bloodied and scarred. In fact, I had to wear 3 t-shirts to school every day. First t-shirt, because the blood would seep through. Second t-shirt, you could still see the blood. Finally, the 3rd t-shirt, you couldn't see any. Kids at school, they make fun of me. Hey, fool, it's 100 degrees. Why are you wearing 3 t-shirts? And then he stopped speaking, so overwhelmed with emotion. And he seemed to be staring at a piece of his story that only he could see. And when he could regain speech through his tears, he said, I wore 3 t-shirts well into my adult years because I was ashamed of my wounds. I didn't want anybody to see them. And now I welcome my wounds. I run my fingers over my scars. My wounds are my friends. After all, how can I help heal the wounded if I don't welcome my own wounds? And awe came upon everyone. The measure of our compassion lies not in our service of those on the margins, but in our willingness to see ourselves in kinship with them. This Youth Day is not the place you've come to. It's always been and only been the place you will go from. And you go from here to stand at the edges, at the margins. And you brace yourself because the world will accuse you of wasting your time. But the prophet Jeremiah writes, in this place of which you say it is a waste, there will be heard again the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voices of those who sing. You go from this place to make those voices heard, not to win the argument or to talk people into submission, but to live the gospel and to put first things recognizably first. People always ask me about enemies working together, and it's certainly difficult initially. A homie will come and say he's ready, and I'll say, I have an opening in the bakery, but you have to work with X, Y, and Z, and I rattle off the names of enemies, rivals. And they always say the same thing. They say, I'll work with them, I'm not going to talk to them. Which always used to bother me in the early days, until you discover that it's impossible for human beings to demonize people they know. Humans can't sustain that. So I had a homie, a little chaparrito, everybody called Youngster. And he was 19 years old. I thought he was ready, so I brought him to our homeboy Silkscreen Factory. And it's a huge place, been around for 20 years. Thousands and thousands of enemy gang members have worked there. So I have youngster there, and I'm introducing him to his 30 coworkers, and I watch him as he shakes hands with each one, staring him in the eye, firm handshake. Lots of enemies, lots of rivals. I think to myself, wow, this is great. Until youngster gets to the last guy, a guy who seems to be wanting to avoid this encounter altogether, a guy everybody called Puppet. And when Puppet and youngster are in each other's vicinity, they mumble something, they stare at their shoes, they won't shake hands. Well, I know they're enemies because I know what gangs they're from, but he just finished shaking hands with a whole bunch of enemies. I discover later that this is a hatred that's really deep and personal and beyond which neither of them think they can really get past. So I sense that much at the moment. I say, look, if you guys can't hang working together, let me know. I got a gang of vatos that want to take your place. Calladitos, they don't say a word. Well, 6 months later, Puppet leaves his home and walks to a corner store some distance from his house. He buys something. But on his way home, he decides for some reason to take a shortcut, and he dodges into an alley. And because of this detour, suddenly, unexpectedly, he's surrounded by 10 members of a rival gang, 10 against 1. And they beat him badly, and he falls to the ground. And they will not stop kicking his head until he's lifeless. Somebody finds his body and takes him to White Memorial Hospital, where he's declared effectively brain dead. But it's the policy there to keep you connected to machines for 48 hours so you can get 2 days of what they call a flat read with no brain activity. And then the doctors can officially sign the death certificate. This allowed family and friends to gather. I was in St. Louis giving a talk. I flew home immediately. I've seen a lot of horrible, terrible things in my life, but nothing to compare to the sight of this young man with his head swollen many times its size. It was horrifying. You could barely train your eyes on him. So at the end of the 48-hour period, I said a blessing over him. I anointed his forehead with oil. We disconnected. A week later, we buried him. But in the first 24 hours, while Puppet was lying beaten in the hospital, I was alone in my office. It was 8:30 at night, and the phone rings, and it was youngster, Puppet's coworker from the silkscreen factory. "Hey," he says, "that's messed up about what happened to Puppet." I said, "Yes, it is." And then with a certain kind of eagerness even, he says, "Is there anything I can do? Can I give him my blood?" And we both fall silent under the weight of it. Until finally, he breaks the silence, choking back his tears. And he says with great deliberation, "He was not my enemy. He was my friend. We worked together." Now, can I say that always happens at Homeboy Industries? Of course it does. Any exceptions? I can't think of a single one. And it shouldn't surprise us that God's own dream come true for us, that we be one, just happens to be our own deepest longing for ourselves. For it turns out, it's mutual. Preach the gospel always, as St. Francis tells us. When necessary, use words. It's not about winning the argument. Jesus doesn't care what position you take on this issue or that issue. He's just wondering, where will you position yourself? We're called to be, as Pope Francis says, a church at the margins. If you stand there, if you position yourself there, that is profoundly, radically announcing the gospel. And you stand at the margins and you look under your feet and they're getting erased. And people will accuse you of wasting your time. But in this place of which you say it is a waste, there will be heard again the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness, the voices of those who sing. This Youth Day has never been the place you've come to. It's only always been the place you will go from. And you go from here to make those voices heard. For the vision still has its time, presses on to fulfillment, and it will not disappoint. And if it delays, we wait for it. Thank you all very much.